Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Revolution in Higher Education. How a Small Band of Innovators Will Make College Accessible and Affordable, by Richard A. DeMillo. Narrated by Joe Barrett. Rather, let me say that there are heroes and martyrs, prophets and apostles of learning, as there are of religion. Daniel Coit Gilman. Foreword. I have spent most of my life in the civil rights movement. Even as a public servant, I fought for human rights. Why is a civil rights leader writing a foreword for a book about higher education? The civil rights movement was always about helping poor people. But in the early days, we talked more about ending discrimination than about ending poverty. The reason was simple. We did not think that economic issues would carry the day in the political climate of the 1960s and 1970s. Ensuring the basic rights of minorities was a cause that appealed to fair-minded Americans of all races and backgrounds. So Dr. King made it the moral foundation for a social contract to end discrimination. Nevertheless, our goal was always to erase the triple evils of racism, war, and poverty. That's what I've been doing my entire life. How things have changed. The country has made progress in ending discrimination, although that progress has to be defended on a continual basis. We see that civil rights in the American South are no different than human rights in South Africa or anywhere else in the world. Basic rights cannot be shared as long as people are excluded. We now know that the triple evils are all about exclusion and inequality, which is what this book is all about. Inequality cannot be wiped out as long as people cannot obtain a quality education. Quality is important for all schools, but it is especially important in post-secondary education, where economic growth often begins. Unfortunately, in colleges and universities around the world, quality means exclusion. Look at any list of the world's most highly regarded universities. They are highly selective institutions. They are elite. They are prestigious because of who they exclude. The whole idea of quality in higher education is based on inequality. That was the theme of Richard DeMillo's book, Abelard to Apple, The Fate of American Colleges and Universities. It was one of the reasons I was drawn to what Rich had to say about the failure of American higher education. It is a theme that he expands on in this book, which describes how higher education will be different if a dedicated group of revolutionaries establish a new social contract. This new contract would ensure that the quality of an institution is judged by how well it serves the people it is intended to serve, not by how many of them it excludes. Abelard to Apple was an excuse for me to think long and hard about the failure of American colleges and universities. It is far easier to attack institutions than to look for reasons they are unable to solve their problems or what they would do if they could. I was intrigued when I heard Rich was writing a book that would tell us what the future might look like. I was even more interested when I found out it might involve a new social contract to democratize education. Rich and I met a decade ago while serving on the board of the Campus Community Partnership, C2P, a foundation that pays tribute to Jimmy and Rosalind Carter's service by engaging college students in social projects. As a result of C2P's work, students from every class and color get introduced to the idea of college. We have been working on expanding access to college ever since, including a unique program called Mentor Walk to make sure that kids from poor neighborhoods actually spend a little time on a college campus and talk to mentors who might be role models. My own heritage is the American Missionary Association, an outgrowth of the Amistad Rebellion and the abolitionist movement that established more than 500 schools and colleges after the Civil War. My parents and grandparents, as well as Coretta Scott King and my late wife, Jean Childs Young, emerged from this education network. It is no accident that the black middle class of the 20th century emerged from the Civil Rights Movement, or that most of the black leaders in Southern Africa emerged from Fort Hare University in South Africa. Nelson Mandela and Desmond Tutu studied there. Fort Hare University also grew out of a missionary movement. When I think of quality in education, I have in mind institutions like these that produce elite leaders and thinkers. That is, fundamentally different from institutions that call themselves elite because of whom they exclude. Knowledge and truth always inspire change. The question today is whether the way we go about teaching and learning are adequate to the demands of technical and financial aspirations on a global scale. Much of the change in the world was produced by the values and vision of higher education. Change, whether by reform, evolution, or revolution, reminds me of an old Christian hymn. New occasions teach new duties. Time makes ancient good uncouth. They must strive upward and onward, who would keep abreast of truth. Higher education today is in serious trouble. A small number of wealthy private institutions, which serve a tiny fraction of the people, are becoming more and more remote. Even at public universities, tuition is too high for most families. Completion rates, especially for kids from poor neighborhoods, are too low. Families pile up debt for college degrees that have little value. Meanwhile, university leaders are rewarded, making things even more unequal. A college that rises in national rankings by becoming more selective is considered a success by alumni and donors. Abelard to Apple is a kind of how the leopard got its spots tale of how inequality crept into higher education. This book looks to the future. It is about what Rich calls a small band of innovators are doing to erase the inequality in higher education. The working title of the original manuscript was Heroes and Martyrs. I was a little disappointed that was not the final title. As a preacher, I found the title to be appealing. The idea of heroes in higher education is taken from Daniel Gilman, the first president of Johns Hopkins University. Gilman thought that there were heroes and martyrs of learning, just like there were apostles of religion. They are all sent forth into the world to change it. The final chapter is about a new social contract for universities. It has the same universal appeal that the human rights movement had 30 years ago. It is inspiring that so many of the central characters are revolutionaries who turn out to be committed to the same ideals. What will be different if this small band of innovators has its way? The world will have access to high-quality education at lower, or no, cost. The idea of remedial education will disappear and be replaced with a more sophisticated understanding of how the brain learns. Remedial education never gets the attention it needs. The idea itself assumes there are two classes of people, those who need remedial coursework because they have failed to learn, and those who don't. Rich believes it is classrooms that have failed, not the students. Innovation can help. For example, he describes classrooms that adapt to the different circumstances that entering students have no control over. Change like this never comes easily. Many in existing institutions fight to maintain their status. Although this is a book about academia, it is not an academic book. Rich, who was also a dean at Georgia Tech and an executive in industry, writes for those of us who are not insiders. We get to see what's really going on and what challenges the revolutionaries face. Revolution is not always easy sledding. Why college costs so much sounds like an easy question, but the answers are not simple. It takes some patience to make the connections with economics and technology. For every complicated questions, there are hopeful stories, like Mississippi's Jackson State University. While most historically black colleges and universities look at their mission as a straitjacket, Jackson State decided to combine technology with its mission as a historically black university to serve more students. Actually, it is only partially true that my interest in Rich's work is tied to high academic and social ideals. I was also drawn by his description of technology that seems unrelated to education. Rich uses stories to draw you into more complicated matters, and I was interested in one of the stories near the end of Abelard to Apple. After many years as an MIT professor and entrepreneur, a distinguished engineer named Soon Nam-pyo returned home to Korea to become president of the Korean Advanced Institute for Science and Technology, KAIST, often called the MIT of Korea. Soo was trying to solve the riddle of how to make KAIST more responsive to the needs of the Korean economy when he hit on the idea of a mobile harbor that could be used to greatly expand the capacity of deep water ports with minimal damage to the environment. This struck me as a wonderful technology that could be used here in Savannah, Georgia, where proposals were being written for a port expansion that would greatly damage the environment. I decided to pursue the same kind of public-private partnership that I had used as mayor to build Atlanta's Hartsfield-Jackson International Airport and use CAIST's mobile harbor technology to expand shipping ports in an environmentally responsible way. As wonderful as this idea was, Sue was an irritant to the existing powers in South Korea and was attacked relentlessly for pushing academic reforms at CAIST. I had seen this kind of irritant before. When I co-chaired the Atlanta Olympic Committee in the 1990s, I became friends with Patrick Creesine, who was president of Georgia Tech at the time. It was Creesine's idea to use virtual reality technology to illustrate Atlanta's proposal for hosting the 1996 Olympic Games. He also remade Georgia Tech. This earned him many admirers, but it also made him an irritant, which earned him many enemies as well. When he passed away, I was asked to make a few remarks at his memorial. "Pat was always right," I said, "and he always got people mad." I understood this completely. Dr. King always said that my role was to be the irritant that kept us focused on the right problems. The small band of innovators that Rich describes is the irritant that higher education needs. I'm looking forward to Rich's next book that I hope will expand on how education and technology can be used to create jobs. In today's world, educational opportunity must be joined by access to capital and job creation. The leaders produced by the revolution in higher education have to provide stability and access to food, energy, water, and shelter for the struggling billions of humanity who now threaten chaos because they are excluded from the lifestyles and opportunities that new technology has made available to the rest of the world. Ambassador Andrew J. Young, Atlanta, 2015. Preface. This book is a companion to my 2011 Abelard to Apple, The Fate of American Colleges and Universities, which I wrote just as the global economy was slipping into the Great Recession. I intended it to be a critical narrative of higher education, explaining, for example, how American colleges arrived at the chasm that separates their comfortable and privileged past from an uncertain fate. When I started working on Abelard, I felt like an outsider, a stranger to the world of policy, economics, regulation, and politics that defines education. But most of the people I knew, even my friends and colleagues who ran schools, colleges, and governing boards, were also outsiders. Few of us, I would discover, understood what was happening to our aging institutions besides what was becoming obvious to anyone who cared to look. They were increasingly costly, inaccessible, and unresponsive to the needs of the 21st century. Meanwhile, innovation seemed to be swirling outside the walls of the academy. I hoped that I could help provoke informed debate among the outsiders. I thought the American system of higher education was in for transformational change of the sort that ancient enterprises rarely experience. I took some care to explain what was in store for the country's colleges and universities, but I believe the events I was describing would take a generation or more to unfold. I badly underestimated the pace and scope that technology field change would have on education worldwide. In amazement, I watched as the magic year of the MOOC, massive open online courses, a crisis of confidence in higher education, and ultimately, the kind of systemic changes that transform institutions, all began to play out in headlines around the world. By the time Abelard appeared in 2011, alarm bells were ringing everywhere. A pile of new books appeared, some decrying and others defending the status quo. News stories carried weekly or daily updates about the bubble in higher education. Government authorities started to examine the sustainability of post-secondary education and dig into why, despite decades of investment, so few Americans actually finished college, while so many piled up debt that would be difficult to repay. There were debates for and against change. Private foundations that had been traditional supporters of slow and steady progress in academia began calling for projects to test disruptive ideas. A small band of innovators, including some of the same college presidents who I had said should be more open to experimentation, decided that the time was right for change. But for many, even university graduates and others who had spent substantial time on college campuses, change seemed painfully slow, and an amazingly large number of people were simply unaware that change was taking place at all. Much as I tried to do in Abelard, I wanted to make this book a simple explanation of what is likely to happen. Most of what is written about higher education is impenetrable to the average person. Academics write treatises for their colleagues. Politicians and journalists who care to write about universities are dismissed because they are too liberal or too conservative, or because they have access to grind. Futurists undermine their own narratives with dire warnings of the imminent collapse of institutions that are in no visible danger. If there is one lesson that can be learned, it is that modern universities operate with a different set of rules, and you have to be unusually diligent to follow what is going on. And yet, innovation is redefining the concept of higher education at an astonishing pace. Those changes will touch virtually everyone. If Abraham Lincoln was correct that creating the future is the best way to predict it, then maybe the best way to predict the future of higher education is to understand what people who are trying to create it are trying to do. This book is loosely organized around Abelard's Rules for the 21st Century, which emphasized the value, technology, costs, academic culture, and need for a new contract with society. This is how I structured my discussions with entrepreneurs, friends, and colleagues, and on many occasions complete strangers, as I was preparing to write. I wanted to know what the innovators were trying to achieve, and they were remarkably candid with me. Would their work mean a crumbling of entrenched institutions? How would students be better off? What would be an inevitable outcome of their success? To my surprise, the same ideas recurred. It did not seem to matter if I was talking to insiders or outsiders, nor did it matter where in the world I was. Everyone I talked to described success in the same way. Taken together, their ideas are a roadmap to a near future being defined by a small band of innovators. I set out to write a very different book than this one. I thought that knowledgeable observers had figured out what was going on, and that I could simply understand and report their forecasts. I was wrong on both counts. First of all, most people view higher education through a personal lens. If you attended a prestigious research university, you have the idea that every college experience resembles that one. If you attended college later in life, you have a hard time relating to higher education as a place that post-adolescents go to mature into adults. Academic insiders have a different understanding of higher education than people who rarely set foot on a college campus. Working on the campus of a research university does almost nothing to prepare you for community college life. Understanding what is going on depends to a large extent on how you relate to a range of experiences that are different from your own. Secondly, I naively thought that there would be little controversy over what the inevitable next steps would be for higher education, particularly once I explained the forces at work and that whatever uncertainty there was would be about timing. The problem was with the very concept of an inevitable next step. How can anyone know what is inevitable? Even if we believe that the changes coming to higher education are not random, undirected developments, that they are the result of the same drivers of change that have transformed society over the past quarter century, just saying what the next steps are casts you in the role of a fortune teller. Like Lincoln, however, I believe it is prudent to pay close attention to the intentions of determined individuals who are trying to change things. If they are successful, their goals are tomorrow's inevitabilities. This is a book about the people who are trying to remake higher education and what they are trying to achieve and why. They are heroes and martyrs of learning, like the ones that Gilman, in the opening epilogue, called to battle over a century ago. Acknoeledgments. This book would not have been possible without the help and cooperation of dozens of people, many mentioned by name, and whose words, ideas, and visions for the future I have freely borrowed and tried to synthesize into a coherent picture. The many others I have talked with over the last 4 years include students, professors, deans, provosts, and presidents at 100 universities, community and business leaders who have vital interests in the health of higher education also shared their ideas with me. We did not always agree on the problems or solutions, but I am deeply indebted to each of them. The faculty, students, and staff at Georgia Tech's Center for 21st Century Universities tested many of the concepts discussed in this book. Their energy was important as this work took shape. Mike McCracken, my director of online innovation, tirelessly pursued the vision of technology-enabled transformation. He has been my collaborator for 30 years, and his ideas are liberally sprinkled throughout this book. Georgia Tech Provost Raphael Brass and President Bud Peterson generously provided financial support and bureaucratic cover for the center's work. Dean Zvi Galil also supplied financial support for the center and an administrative home for our work. Most important, he enthusiastically embraced our message and became our greatest advocate. The Board of Regents and Office of the Chancellor of the University System of Georgia, especially Vice Chancellor Lynn Weisenbach and System Provost Houston Davis, let us infect their strategic thinking and imagine a better way to educate the state's 300,000 students. Ambassador Andrew Young has been generous with his time over the years. My discussion of historically black colleges and universities, HBCUs, would not have been possible without him. It is impossible to live in Atlanta and not feel the presence of institutions like Morehouse and Spelman, but the rest of higher education knows far too little about HBCUs. I regret that I could not tell their story in more detail here. My friends R.K. and Sue Segal, along with the other board members of the Campus Community Partnership Foundation, provided indispensable feedback on many of the ideas in this book. The Segals opened their home one remarkable evening to an unscripted gathering of college and university presidents. It was like an informal tribal council, and although I have not directly used their words, their shared sense of mission and concern for the public good infected my thoughts about how this book should be written. Ben Kunczynski, Jonathan Cole, Zvi Galil, and Eric Grimson each offered important historical information. The Lumina and Qatar Foundations also both generously supported my work. I am immensely grateful. Former MIT President Chuck Vest passed away as the manuscript for this book was being completed. Chuck was one of the heroes mentioned by Daniel Coit Gilman, although when he first explained the idea of open courseware to me, I suggested that if the initiative went awry, he might be a martyr. When we last spoke, I reminded him of this. He said that when he proposed the idea, he was not sure how it was all going to turn out, but he was sure that the world would never be the same. My patient and supportive MIT Press editor, Marie Lufkin Lee, and the anonymous reviewers whose unvarnished advice reshaped the first unwieldy manuscripts were unusually dedicated to helping me find a voice for the heroes of this book. My colleague Mark Bronstein made room in his busy schedule to read the final manuscript and root out not-so-obvious errors and defects. Finally, my colleague of 40 years, Richard Lipton, and my companion, friend, and wife, Ronnie Martin, generously agreed to review drafts and provide me much-needed criticism. Over the years, they have listened to many ideas that, in addition to those that found their way into the book, never went anywhere. Despite the generous contributions of my colleagues and collaborators, all defects, errors, and shortcomings are mine alone. Introduction. I clicked my headset to the on position, and the voice in my ear said, "So this is a big deal, isn't it?" It was not really a question, more like a judgment, and I was supposed to concur. There was no, "Hello, how are you?" And if I had asked, "What are you talking about?" the call would have been over. But this was my fifth conversation with a reporter since lunch, and it was only 2 p.m. "Yes, it is a big deal," I said. I had the embargoed press release, and so did the reporter. She wanted to find out what else I knew. Does this change everything? I did not think so. It's a sign that everything has changed, I replied. The story appeared online Friday. Print versions ran over the weekend. By Monday, there were dozens of sites that ran their own versions of the story, and the international press had begun covering the original press announcement. By Wednesday, every major news organization in the world had covered what was being called a revolution in higher education. Everyone I talked to expected that the press would be interested for only a couple of days. A few bloggers would try to keep it going longer, but except for sports, scandals, and an occasional fascination with eccentric geniuses, there had never been a great public appetite for what happens in ivy-covered halls. By next month, it would all be forgotten. It turned out to be a bigger deal than I thought. Maybe a fascination with eccentric geniuses. You have to be isolated from the events of the world to not know that colleges and universities are big news. It used to be hard to find a newspaper that had much interest in higher education, but for many months now, it has been impossible to avoid big, bold-faced headlines and breathless investigative reports about the future of universities. It is a global phenomenon. Americans may be worried about rising tuition, low completion rates, unemployed graduates, and the $1 trillion in debt that they have racked up. Yet every region of the world looks at its system of higher education, concludes that it is in trouble, and wonders what the future holds in store. Experts are divided on that question, but there is one thing that most of them agree on. Higher education is being remade before our eyes. This is a book about the future of the world's colleges and universities. It is not a book about what I think is going to happen, or even what I wish would happen. It is not a book that defends the status quo or proposes throwing out 1,000 years of history and starting over again. It is not even a book about charting a middle course. It is a chronicle of an agenda for massive global change. It is an explanation of what some dedicated and inventive people want to accomplish as they set out to remake higher education. It is also about the obstacles, along with the opponents, arrayed against them. Above all, though, it is about what the result will be if these people succeed. One thing is certain. If they have their way, everything about higher education will be changed forever. What is happening to the world's colleges and universities is, in every sense, a revolution. In fact, let us agree at the outset what to call the events that started in the offices of MIT President Charles M. Vest in 2000 and intensified over the next decade until, like a tsunami, they overwhelmed the public's understanding of what a college education means. Revolution. If that sounds too dramatic, it is best to keep in mind that history is dotted with other revolutions like this one. Few of us, for example, think of college as a place where students directly pay instructors based on how well they teach, although the first universities were organized exactly that way 1,000 years ago. Even the idea that a college degree prepares students for careers was revolutionary in its day. Over the following pages, I will help you keep that history in mind. What makes this revolution different is the scale of the global enterprise of higher education. There are about 50,000 colleges and universities in the world, enrolling as many as 1 billion people. Industrialized nations devote 4% of their gross domestic product to higher education. National economies rest on the health of local universities. The times also make this revolution different. It occurs at a nexus of technological, social, and economic change that has never happened before. Everyone who has experienced the birth and adolescence of the Internet knows that the pace of technological innovation now makes possible what was impossible a generation ago. That pace is accelerating, and it is hard for anyone outside academia to understand what is taking place. Even within the academy, there is much that is hidden from view. This book is a peek behind a curtain that is usually drawn. I have chosen an American lens to show what is going on and why. What began as a few Silicon Valley experiments now engulfs hundreds of institutions of higher learning and tens of millions of students in 50 countries. A small band of innovators, the term comes from Daniel Coy Gilman's inaugural address as the first president of Johns Hopkins University and his imagery of a small band of well-chosen professors, heroes and martyrs, apostles and prophets of learning, has chosen this path. But it is not a coordinated assault. It would be a mistake to think that the revolution is about a single movement or single technology. It is better to envision the revolution as a set of aspirations about what the world's colleges and universities could become. It is about the intertwined stories of the innovators and what they want to achieve, a series of events that once put in motion cannot be recalled. What makes this time different? This is not the first time that experts have warned of impending doom. Higher education always seems to defy gloomy predictions that the whole enterprise is about to collapse. The academy looks at history and, unimpressed, shrugs its collective shoulders and continues on its way. It was that way when the first European universities were founded 1,000 years ago. It continued into the 20th century with its cycle of calls for a dramatic reform, quick and certain action to avoid sinking the entire system, followed by resistance to change. The challenges always seem grave. Most planners expect that demographics will lead to enrollment declines, even with other trends taken into account, said forecasts of the 1980s. The system was facing financial strains of crisis proportions, warned the National Association of State Universities and Land-Grant Colleges in 1971. Economist Earl Chite wrote a landmark report that predicted a new Great Depression in higher education. The gap between Depression-era family income and the costs of higher education alarmed economists in the 1930s. Students' needs were being insufficiently attended to, said critics in the mid-19th century. Wild swings between student apathy and rebellion prompted college presidents to admit that the collegiate way might be too much for vigorous young men to bear. The Second Great Awakening in the early 1800s jeopardized the intellectual nature of a college education with a torrent of religious piety. Even the famous medieval universities in Bologna and Paris were publicly derided as moribund homes of outmoded knowledge. The experts were wrong. In the end, universities emerged little changed from centuries of unrelenting criticism. There was no precipitous drop in enrollment after the last of the World War II baby boomers graduated in the early 1970s. The depression that Chite predicted turned out to be more about inflation and energy prices, problems that had eased by 1985. The land-grant movement, curriculum modernization, intercollegiate athletics, and disappearance of dueling from American life resolved many on-campus tensions. Those issues that were not so easily resolved waxed and waned with the social issues of the times. And so here we are, perched atop the most emulated system of post-secondary education in the world. By most reckoning, the trends in higher education in the United States and most of the industrialized world have pointed upward for a long time. Defenders of tradition and purists would say it was their stubborn resistance to calls for massive change that was the key, and whatever ailed American universities was easily treated with patience and discipline, but seldom with help from the outside. Predictions of disaster have inevitably been followed by rebirth. Every new golden age comes on the heels of such a renaissance. The cycle is so predictable that academics are trained to be cynical about change. There have always been calls to reform. Everyone says this time is different, but it never is. We have seen all this before, the purists say. Reform is best done slowly, and only when it does not disrupt the well-oiled machine that is higher education. And besides, new ideas are few and far between. Even if we wanted to remake higher education, assert professors and administrators alike, we don't think there is anything that can replace what we already have. Of course, the fact that in the past everyone claimed this time is different does not rule out the possibility that this time really is different. Why remake higher education? There is an optimistic narrative of higher education. In it, all downturns are temporary and best endured by appealing to the virtues of the academic endeavor. That optimism vanished with the 20th century. By mid-2011, problems facing American higher education that had once seemed distant and abstract became suddenly acute with a global economic crisis of historic dimensions. Tax revenues that had subsidized costs for public universities rapidly dried up, and, faced with unprecedented budget cuts, most institutions steered a disastrous middle course of raising tuition and cutting costs. Private universities subsidized costs with earnings from endowments. Endowment income was among the first casualties of the 2008 stock market crash. Many smaller institutions were also forced to raise tuition. Hundreds were driven into chaos, and many more to the brink of financial ruin. Despite this, most college presidents were convinced that things were not so bad. Few made structural changes to adapt to a new fiscal reality. As a result, issues that should have been worked out over a generation quickly became immediate crises. Graduates of respected programs could not find jobs. Default rates on student loans soared. A string of highly critical studies cast doubt on how well universities were doing at their primary job of teaching post-adolescents to think critically, reason quantitatively, and communicate effectively. Opportunists were quick to point fingers. Some said it was a bloated administrative class that was causing all the trouble. Others thought it was due to a lazy and entitled professoriate. Failure was laid at the feet of an education system that did not prepare high school students properly. Too much infusion of corporate management has destroyed the very ideal of higher education, said those who were repelled by the notion that professors needed to be managed and instead cherished the collaborative atmosphere of academic communities. Too little top-down direction has allowed many universities to lurch from crisis to crisis, pursuing strategies that benefit neither students nor the public, maintained others. As public confidence in higher education began to wane, a major candidate for the U.S. presidency said that the middle-class American dream of a college degree amounted to snobbery, and many agreed with him. Negative press coverage of the problems facing higher education was relentless. College presidents across the board insisted that they were doing a good job and that restoring lost funds was all that was needed. But the brand of higher education was being damaged by daily withering criticism. If this was one of those cyclic downturns that shortly would be eased by an improving economy, the signs of reversal needed to appear soon, because the sustainability of the idyllic social academic enterprise was in doubt. As I write this, 5 years after the deepest part of the recession, there is a consensus among knowledgeable observers that American higher education had not been on a sustainable path for a long time. This comes as a shock to outsiders who look at the American institutions at the top of annual rankings of world universities as models to be emulated. U.S. Secretary of Education Arne Duncan calls them the islands of excellence. Yet they are irrelevant islands of excellence to the vast majority of college students who do not have access to them. Unlike their elite cousins, most American colleges and universities are locked in a system that is anything but excellent. Most American institutions fall into a great middle, the nearly 4,000 colleges and universities that lie just below the elites in the hierarchy of higher education. Elite institutions have global brands and the financial wherewithal to determine their own fate. A degree from an elite carries with it a promise of considered treatment by employers and strong likelihood of financial rewards. But it is the middle that enrolls 80% of all college students. If you are a recent high school graduate, odds are high that you will attend a college in the middle rather than an elite institution. If you are a part-time student, adult retooling for a second career, returning veteran, recent immigrant, or single parent, the odds are overwhelming that you will attend expensive and crowded classes in the middle. If you happen to be one of the lucky 20% who actually earns a degree, you will almost certainly find that those classes do little to distinguish you from thousands of other job seekers in a crowded marketplace. When policymakers and political leaders talk about the higher education system, they are really speaking about the middle. There are clear signs that the middle is headed for trouble. It is in financial disrepair. Credit rating agencies say that it is a bad bet. There are credible estimates that as many as half of all institutions could be insolvent within 15 years. Soaring institutional debt and a cost disease that causes labor costs to rise at twice the rate of inflation have pushed prices beyond the reach of most American households. Student loan debt jumped past credit card debt, passing the $1 trillion mark sometime in late 2012. Many students graduate from college with grade inflated degrees in fields that are in low demand by employers, and many more fail to graduate at all, but are burdened with debt nevertheless. The end result is a soaring default rate for student loans. 40 million current and former students hold federally secured loans, and one out of every seven defaults within 2 years of graduation. Finally, public confidence in higher education is on the decline. For the first time, the majority of Americans question the value of a college degree. This lack of confidence is expressed in decreased overall spending for public universities and declining applications for many private universities. As unnerving as these trends are for the middle, the elites seem to be immune from their effects. The American model is one in which a handful of institutions, hand-picking students and setting prices as high as they wish, become ever more remote. The remaining institutions fight it out over the rest. The rest consists not only of average students, both full and part-time, but also students poorly prepared for college, along with, increasingly, adult learners, first-generation college students, and recent immigrants. These students are less likely to successfully complete college and more likely to take out unaffordable loans. Institutions in the middle are judged on factors like completion rates and percentage return on investment of tuition dollars, so many of the rest of these students are not the bread and butter that most institutions want to attract. Higher education in the United States has evolved to accommodate this state of affairs. The system was designed 100 years ago when relatively few people attended college. To accommodate more students, schools adopted a factory approach to education, in which raw materials, students, were sorted by age and ability into batches, classes, to receive uniform doses of content, classes, curricula, and majors. Like defective products on an assembly line, students who did not make the grade were rejected, failed. Factory operations were supposed to be carried out under the watchful eye of managers, administrators and trustees, and quality assurance experts, accreditors. This was an adequate system for many years. But by 2011, it became clear that what was being demanded of higher education had changed. Students had changed. Quality had declined. Most important, the very idea of an educational factory had reached its limits. Without innovation, rising costs would continue to drive a wedge between those who could afford a quality education and the vast majority of American families whose income would rise slightly, if at all. And not just any innovation would make a difference. Productivity would need to be improved, but so would quality. This kind of innovation had stopped. The factories were not evolving, and it was obvious why. Improving productivity meant that fewer professors would be needed. Institutional missions would be streamlined. More would be demanded for less money. It was time to either fix the factories or replace them with something more suited to the needs of society, and maybe something better. There had never been a more compelling moment to remake higher education. The current path was not sustainable, and a new wave of technological innovation provided an alternative to factories, enabling better, more affordable learning for more students. It was an idea that gradually began to infect a group of fearless people who were prepared to do something about it. By 2011, it was apparent what they had in mind. A small band of innovators. There had been calls for reform before, but somehow this time seemed different to a handful of university leaders and Silicon Valley entrepreneurs. For one thing, they realized that they had cheaper, far more effective technologies at their disposal. Many people within academia concluded that the arguments for remaking higher education were ones they had heard before, that there was nothing different this time. But others had concluded the opposite. higher education had to be remade because it had become unsustainable in its current form. And what made this time different was that there were now tools of change widely available to anyone who might wish to try something new. It was possible to start a revolution when nothing less than a revolution was called for. But who would lead it? Who would tinker with the very idea of a university? And what would higher education look like afterward? One theory of innovation is that outsiders play a pivotal role, particularly when the innovation disrupts an otherwise successful venture. Disruption requires an irrational thought. Why don't we stop what we are doing now, what we have done well, and what has been profitable to us and useful to our customers, and do this new, untested thing that has a good chance of failing? A rational person would only do that if the old, previously valuable thing was about to disappear, to lose its value to customers or become prohibitively expensive, for example. Even in the rational light of day, there are usually powerful incentives for insiders to avoid innovation. After all, there is ample evidence that the success of innovative disruption comes at the expense of insiders. In 1934, American populist Upton Sinclair devised a utopian scheme for ending the Depression in California. Sinclair's plan was the single platform plank in his failed bid for the governor's mansion. At the height of a surprisingly modern political fight that featured dirty tricks and hostile local newspapers, Sinclair hit on the reason that insiders reject innovation. It takes an outsider, he said, because it is difficult to get a man to understand something when his salary depends on his not understanding it. Higher education is not too far removed from Sinclair's Depression-era politics. There is little good that will happen to academic insiders who embrace the idea that the system is in a state of collapse. According to another theory, disruptive innovation is a random process. It is impossible to predict where it will arise and whether it will succeed or fail. Otherwise, insiders would be innovating all the time. In industries like education, healthcare, politics, and energy, there are many stakeholders with competing interests. Insiders with disruptive ideas are as likely to be advantaged by their own inventions as not. Yet these are also the industries that have been the most resistant to change. Resistant, but not immune. Examples abound. The medical establishment rejected the use of surgical antiseptics well into the 19th century, despite scientific evidence of their effectiveness. Widespread adoption occurred only as a result of public outcry over the avoidable death of U.S. President James Garfield. Insiders and outsiders often play equally important roles, but it always seems to be a small band of innovators who disrupt the status quo. In California's Silicon Valley, a financial analyst named Salman Khan had the idea to use a free drawing program to tutor his cousins in mathematics. He had a knack for making easily understandable explanations of complicated ideas, and when others sought his help, he began to post short videos of his lessons on YouTube to an audience that quickly grew to millions of viewers. Free distribution of educational materials was an idea that had insider help. Some years before Khan started posting his videos, MIT president and consummate insider Charles Vest had made all the university's courseware freely available to anyone in the world with a web browser. Realizing that students might want to enroll in courses and organize educational content, seven Apple computer engineers created iTunes U, a section of its iTunes online music store, and devoted it to free, downloadable academic content. At Stanford University, computer science professors Daphne Kohler and Jennifer Whittam were experimenting with how to invert the roles of lectures and homework when they came on the idea of using internet technology to open up Stanford classrooms to an even larger audience. Coincidentally, their colleague Andrew Ng had for several years been intrigued with the notion that classroom time was being wasted and technology could help focus a professor's time on more productive learning activities. When their courses were offered on Stanford's Open Learning website, 150,000 students signed up. Enrollment numbers of that size were unprecedented, and the professors must have been impressed because they quickly decided to form a company to pursue the vision of opening their classrooms to the world. Meanwhile, Sebastian Thrun, another Stanford professor, sent an email to his contacts announcing that he and Google's Peter Norvig would be offering a free version of Stanford's artificial intelligence course using the web. Again, 150,000 students enrolled in the class, including most of Thrun's on-campus Stanford students, and like his colleagues, Thrun was so moved that he publicly announced that he was leaving his Stanford position to devote himself to this new way of learning. A continent away, Professor Anant Agarwal was using MIT's OpenCourseWare to teach an online version of his required engineering class to 160,000 students, declaring that he would provide MIT-branded certificates to students who successfully completed the course. Far from the startup culture of Silicon Valley, Jackson State University's provost, James Rennick, was working on how technology might help the struggling historically black university to reinvent itself when Robert Blaine, a Jackson State music professor, realized that content authoring tools would achieve two goals at once. They would permit a different kind of pedagogy than competitors were able to offer and would attract a different kind of student. In Canada, George Siemens and two of his colleagues began offering what they called massive open online courses, MOOCs, that enrolled several thousand students who were interested in Siemens' research into learning. Even the science underpinning educational technology seemed to be accelerating. Armed with the same tools that professional politicians were using to predict the outcome of elections, a new breed of data analysts was using artificial intelligence to sift through tens of millions of mouse clicks, keystrokes, and homework exercises to predict which individual students would need learning systems to adapt to their needs. Cognitive scientists were mapping learning activities to brain functions and using the result to reorganize classrooms to better match how the brain actually learns. And the brain itself was at the heart of a revolution in neuroscience as chemists, computer scientists, and biologists discovered new ways of seeing into the very process of cognition. Nobel Prize winners like University of British Columbia's Carl Wieman were experimenting with how to replace cold and impersonal learning factories with interactive experiences that help students think like scientists, economists, and sociologists. Wieman had recently taken his passion to the Obama White House, where he, along with a cadre of journalists and science writers, began to proselytize the newly rediscovered work of K. Anders Ericsson on the psychology of knowledge acquisition. College presidents wondered openly about how to use pedagogical methods that would have been prohibitively expensive only a few years before. Boards of trustees questioned whether investing in large lecture halls that had changed little in 500 years was a good idea. All of a sudden, there was an abundance of interest in pedagogy and educational technology, causing some to hope that the entire system was about to transform itself. But transforming islands of excellence into a system of excellence is a challenging task. It involves the kind of systemic change that universities do not like to make. Despite widespread agreement that change was needed, there were varied opinions about what that change should look like and how quickly it should come. Arizona State University President Michael Crow had been a lonely voice, making enemies by pointing out the obvious failure of research universities that, in a quest for prestige, had become more exclusive and remote from the people they were supposed to serve. Crow's message was a distant echo of academic chronicler Edwin Slosson's call a century before to judge a university not by how well it scores on self-defined measures of success, but instead by how well it serves the people it is supposed to serve. Crow began to create what he called a new gold standard for American universities that, like Rennick's Jackson State University, would use technology to erase the accidental differences in circumstances among entering students, many of whom came from impoverished and underserved neighborhoods, environments in which attending college was regarded as a risk rather than an opportunity. Outsiders like internet entrepreneur Ben Nelson believed that too much money was being wasted in higher education and that with a single-minded focus on delivering a quality educational experience, the cost of even an elite education could be brought back down to earth so that the average family could afford it. It was an outrageously ambitious goal. But former Harvard President Larry Summers and Nebraska Senator Bob Kerry, who had served as president of New York's New School, quickly backed it. In 2011, though, the public view of higher education was pessimistic, And that pessimism was reinforced by each new study showing that academic leaders were, by and large, more interested in stewardship of an old yet comfortable existence than they were in listening to critics. American elites had little incentive to change, and change without the active involvement of the top of the academic pyramid was impossible. But then the outsider theory started to crumble. Influential insiders began to say in public what critics had been reporting all along. Unequal access was a threat to higher education. Stanford's president, John Hennessy, said that the cost of maintaining a large faculty was not sustainable, and predicted that in the future, there would be fewer professors, but they would be using new technologies to teach more students. He then took a mini sabbatical, a rarity for university presidents, to acquire a deep understanding of educational technology. University of Pennsylvania Provost Vincent Price threw the full weight of his prestigious Ivy League institution behind Coursera, the company that Kohler and Ung had founded based on their Stanford courses. Raphael Reif, MIT's new president, declared a kind of moral war on increasingly inaccessible quality education. Georgia Tech President George Bud Peterson agreed to use technology to make the university's prestigious computer science master's degree available for 20% of the on-campus price. At the University of Virginia, Helen Dragas, the appointed head of the university's governing board, took on an entrenched and entitled culture over the question of affordable access to what she called the Commonwealth's university. Most of this activity was hidden from public view, so it was totally unexpected that 2012 would see sweeping change in the United States, and even more unexpectedly, the beginning of a global revolution to redefine the nature and value of universities, a movement offering education to many millions of students around the world who desired it. It was dubbed the Magic Year. A small band had decided to challenge the basic assumptions of higher education. These challenges were not simply to the status quo. They consisted of projects aimed at changing the way education worked. The innovators had an agenda, and if they were successful, there would be an inevitable change in colleges and universities, and likely education in general. It was to be a revolution that redrew the map of the world. But most everyone involved was unprepared for the national and international reaction to the revolution of that magic year. How this book is organized. What follows is both a chronicle of a revolution and a roadmap for the future. If successful, the small band of innovators will have changed something important about the way education is conceived and delivered. They will have altered the economics of running a university, culture of academic life, and nature of the contract between higher education and society. I also include a healthy dose of history. That is in part because I believe that the future of academic freedom, college affordability, and the value of a university degree is connected to their past, as well as to the cast of characters who define the modern university. I include history for another reason. Few of the innovators who appear in these pages believe there is anything unique about universities among the panorama of human endeavors and institutions. Politics, finances, society, and individual self-interest play exactly the same role in academia as in other aspects of modern existence. It would be unlikely, for example, that a general economic principle that has been observed over and over again through the decades would, all of a sudden and without cause, cease to apply to higher education. History in one arena might reasonably be expected to inform future events in another. The success of the revolution counts on this. And so a retelling, however brief, of how things turned out for others sheds light on what we should expect the band of innovators to accomplish. Revolution. I have divided the chronicle into four parts, beginning with an explanation of what the revolution seeks to accomplish. The idea that change was afoot for higher education burst on the public consciousness with Thrun's announcement that he had resigned his professorship at Stanford to begin offering free, high-quality university courses to the world. It was a bold statement, but it was only the first. Stanford and MIT announcements quickly followed. Kahn became a spokesperson for short-format lectures that would reach millions. Startup capital poured into research labs and storefront software companies that were more reminiscent of the early days of the Internet than the staid, bureaucratically top-heavy business of running a university. The difference was noticeable, and it captured the attention of international media for much of 2012, the magic year. Chapter 1 tells the intertwined stories of the key players and their motivations. The magic year was about MOOCs, but it was also about the value of a college education, along with the ease with which simple course content could be replicated and distributed to anyone with an internet connection. To survive in the future, an institution would have to add value beyond a simple recital of information, because that was being rapidly commoditized by technology. But even simple survival may not be easy when landscapes shift. Universities are generally conceived as vertically integrated entities. But as soon as families realize that they do not have to pay for unadorned content, the natural question is, well, exactly what do I have to pay for? This is the central concern in Chapter 2. Affordable quality is a goal of the revolution, but it is achieved through an unbundling of a university's value proposition that allows students to pay only for the value they receive. This is an innocent-sounding, although in fact dramatic, shift in the landscape of higher education. The revolution would leave education poorer, but for an improved understanding of how to organize the learning process in a way that more closely matches how the brain learns. Chapter 3 explains how learning begins, deep within the brain, where a continual cycle of neurotransmitter production and reinforcement literally rewires neurons as small chunks of learned information move from short to long-term memory. It is this chemical engine of motivation and reward that new educational technology supports. And if its inventors are correct, the end result will be a different kind of classroom, in which long-form lectures have all but disappeared, replaced by a different kind of learning experience. What will fill the void is an approach called mastery learning, which has been known since the 1980s to deliver superior results in almost every conceivable classroom. Cost has been the principal barrier to the widespread adoption of mastery learning techniques. Without new technology, this kind of classroom learning is prohibitively expensive. But the revolution aims to remove that obstacle. It is a long way from understanding the principles of improved learning to changing what happens in the classroom, a journey that is described in Chapter 4. Educational innovations often face insurmountable hurdles, but the development of technology-enhanced learning is accelerating exponentially. Even from today's vantage point, the outlines of what is achievable are apparent, and they do not resemble the first primitive MOOC technology or faltering business models of traditional online education. Show me the industry that has withstood the advance of technology, say the innovators, and history usually proves them correct. Artificial intelligence makes it possible to personalize classrooms, even when course content is being distributed to a mass audience. Sophisticated analytic algorithms predict where students are likely to have problems and provide clues to master teachers about how to proceed. Even more important, technological innovation can be used to erase inequalities in circumstances, cognitive ability, social status, or academic knowledge that plague post-secondary education as it scales to the masses. If technology-enhanced learning succeeds, it will be because of scale. The technologies of the revolution are the technologies of the Internet. That makes them profoundly different from the past. Chapter 5 explains how the revolution plans to migrate the business of higher education to the Internet, with all the gains in productivity that might entail. Improved classroom productivity means that the structure of academic institutions will change. The number of professors will necessarily decline, a profound shift for an industry that computes the ratio of teachers to students and uses the result as a measure of quality. Teams will form around effective teachers, but they will be teams of specialists. This flies in the face of older models of education, yet it is where the small band of innovators is taking us, because higher education cannot continue to expand at the current rate. Conquering the problem of scale will require new kinds of institutions. Rationale for a revolution. Part 2 of this book explains what the revolution aims to change. What do innovators believe is so severely broken in higher education that the whole venture needs to be remade? No one would start such a wholesale dismantling of a successful enterprise without a rationale. But many inside and outside academia regard dramatic change as an inevitable product of market forces and shifting social priorities and want to make sure that what follows is worthy. Others have far narrower goals, say changing the course of failing institutions. Still others want to topple institutions in order to redefine what it means to be a university. It is hard to get agreement on whether the failings of higher education justify a revolution, though there are reasons for doubting that evolutionary forces will make college more affordable or that prevailing expensive bureaucracies have any meaningful impact at all on educational outcome. The revolutionaries have seen unfolding events like these before. Incumbents bent on preserving their position when the forces of change suggest that their favored status has been undermined. On the other hand, it is apparent that the culture of academic institutions perpetuates not just meritocracies, but also hierarchies of elites. It is a culture based on costly, self-defeating institutional envy masquerading as strategy. These are the targets for reformers and revolutionaries that Part 2 explains, beginning with the shifting business landscape of higher education. Understanding shifting landscapes requires a basic understanding of geography. In this case, the financial geography of higher education, which is the subject of Chapter 6. For most of society, the finances of higher education mean the cost of a college degree. When higher education is heavily subsidized, as it is in Europe and used to be for American public universities, society bears that cost. Otherwise, the cost of a university education determines the price that individuals pay in the form of tuition. Tuition has risen dramatically, alarmingly by most reckoning, driving a wedge between families and a college degree. Quality college education is rapidly becoming inaccessible. Policymakers and the public are, for the most part, misinformed about what is behind this rise in college costs, and that is a dangerous combination. Higher education suffers from a cost disease that causes prices to rise, and understanding what leads to the disease is an important first step in seeking solutions. Reformers are betting that the affordability gap, which can be closed by technology or an unbundling of prices, will dominate the economics of higher education for the foreseeable future. Universities often lose sight of which people they are intended to serve, and this revolution was launched in part to bring that back into focus. Higher education is hierarchical, a pyramid, with a few institutions at the top and the rest defining their value not in terms of serving their students or communities, but rather by which of their competitors occupy a coveted position a rung or two above them. For some universities, prestige is all that matters. For them, the pyramid is a hierarchy of the elite in which institutions are not defined by who they serve, but instead by who they exclude. For many others, particularly those public universities that cannot be exclusive, rankings are what matter and have become the bedrock measure of academic quality. For all except those few at the top, envy like this is synonymous with strategy. An overwhelming majority of universities promise world-class status, even when that flies in the face of common sense and the needs of their students. The next three chapters explain the fixation with elitism, rankings, and strategies based on envy, the ecosystem that promotes the resulting hierarchies, and what will replace them if the small band is successful. To the ramparts. Not everyone is happy with the prospect of change, so revolutionaries will encounter stiff opposition. Part 3 of this book looks at how the revolution will run headlong into an entrenched and successful academic culture that abhors the kind of change that innovation seeks to bring. University brands, for example, will be displaced if some of the innovative approaches to online education are successful. Yet in academia, brands are difficult to establish and hard, but not impossible, to damage. Whether online education can be branded at the same high level as elite education is the provocative question that occupies Chapter 10. What happens when a new kind of university decides to concentrate all its resources on classroom achievement? Most universities misjudge their own brands, mistaking a long-time monopoly on access to top students for value. Technology has commoditized high-quality dissemination of information, so universities that base their value on guarding access to that information now find their gatekeeper status undermined, bypassed by a new economy. Innovators are counting on this. If their students learn more and are better able to compete in a global marketplace, it will not matter that they do not have the usual badges of acceptance conveyed by academic peers. Universities are scholarly communities that regard their work as existing on a different plane from most other human endeavors. To succeed, the revolution has to confront the resistance of academic culture. Chapter 11 takes on the ivory tower culture of academia and tendency to regard intrusion into that culture as a moral assault. The course of academic institutions in the last half of the 20th century has left many irreparable cracks in the ivory tower. But the edifice of academic freedom, which the ivory tower guards, remains largely intact and well defended by institutions like peer review and tenure. Chapter 11 shows how easy it is to build an ivory tower culture in a modern university and how resilient it can be, even when it fails. The relentless onslaught of innovation threatens ivory tower institutions such as tenure. Market forces guarantee academic freedom, say the revolutionaries. If they are right, the ivory tower will crumble. Chapter 11 also examines how the prevailing idea of sharing academic governance among many constituents has become a barrier to technological advances in the universities where it is the strongest. The question, who is in charge, has been replaced in recent years by a more confrontational choice, labor versus management. By framing technological change as an assault on justice, an organized labor movement has come to higher education, and it has been responsible for exposing underlying contradictions that must be resolved by opposing forces. These forces clash in dramatic fashion in Chapter 12, which pits the concept of legitimate governance against what many who want institutional reform see as the ability of a mob to run roughshod over the needs of students and society. Paradoxically enough, it is the very technology of the revolution that also amplifies the ability of a small group to promote polarization. The Internet has enabled the rise of empires which maintain their value systems and cultures by exaggerating the consequences of dissent. A resulting clash of cultures came to a head in the 2012 firing of University of Virginia President Teresa Sullivan by a reform-minded board. The events that followed present unresolved questions for the small band of innovators. A new social contract. The central questions facing colleges and universities have not changed much over the last 100 years. 1. Does an institution serve the people it is supposed to serve? 2. Are there among an institution's graduates a sufficiently large number of successes? 3. Successes aside, how well do most graduates do a decade or more after receiving their degrees? 4. What exactly have an institution's graduates learned? 5. How important is an institution to its constituents? Universities have always been social enterprises, and it is likely that the social contexts and unique circumstances that give rise to particular institutions will continue to be as important as many of the other forces, commoditization of content, economic inequality, failures in governance, and homogenization, affecting higher education. Revolutionaries have already succeeded in making simple delivery of content to distant parts of the globe cheap and simple. Old institutions have lost their privileged status. The ivory tower has been replaced by the multiversity. Academic workforces are being restructured. Virtual and physical spaces coexist. But a university must still serve the people it was intended to serve. It must be important to someone or someplace. Part 4 explores the nature of the compact between society and its universities. It is no utopian dream to expect a written compact. In return for funding, trust, and the commitment to respect academic boundaries, universities agree to engage with society. In fact, the world's oldest functioning written constitution says that society has a duty to cherish the interests of universities in exactly this way. This is in every respect a social contract. and it has been renewed over time. But it has faded from both public consciousness and institutional missions over the last century. If the small band of innovators succeeds in remaking higher education, it will be because they offer to renew this contract in ways that traditional institutions are reluctant to do. It will be because new institutions rise to the challenge of instilling in their students not only that education has value, but also values, virtues for the common good. And it will be because governments consider that to be a duty of society. Revolutions and revolutionaries. Higher education is engaged in a global revolution, and like Gilman's apostles of learning, there will be heroes and martyrs among the revolutionaries. Ideas that seem fresh and ambitious today may turn into dead ends that fall to the realities of economics, politics, or the changing tastes of a global public. There may be a new awakening in which the diffusion of knowledge is viewed as essential to preserving modern thoughts and cultures. There may be new agreements that codify a commitment to self-governance, integrity, egalitarianism, truth, and interpersonal trust that define both the responsibilities of society and obligations of members of academic communities. Knowledge may be viewed in the future as a community possession. The global academic enterprise may adopt Andrew Ng's mission of ensuring that quality instruction is a global right. Bright-eyed revolutionaries may cause otherwise immutable bureaucracies to relinquish their grip on access to education. No matter what happens, universities in the future will have been forever transformed because of the events that a few fearless innovators set in motion at the start of the millennium. Exactly what that transformation looks like can only be guessed at, although the outlines are made apparent through the lens of history. The reasons that humankind invented universities are eternal, and what we ask today of scholars and their institutions will not be greatly changed by the successes or failures of a few technologies or new ways of doing business. Still, no institution has an entitled position in this vast new landscape. That is how we arrived at a crossroad. My retelling of this journey in Abelard to Apple ends with the following exchange with an academic leader who reveled in his institution's increasing selectivity. He stopped. I pressed him. Where will those students go in 100 years? What will the universities that have the capacity for the students who turn away look like? He realized that I was asking what the university of the 21st century would look like. After a long pause, he said, "It will not look like us." Many people have taken up the mission of answering this question, and among them are heroes who, possessing no dread of labor, no fear of consequences, no desire for wealth, are carried to success. That is where we begin.
1. Revolution. 1. Map of the World. The magic year begins not with grand agreements among ministers or presidential flourishes, but rather with the almost imperceptible ceding of territory, a series of small revolts that proceed with breathtaking speed. No battering rams breach campus gates, no pillaging of academic programs, no coup d'états. It begins with old ideas that have never been tested, and with genius, ambition, and opportunity. It begins with rare ability to seize the moment. A project to shake up the world. When Stanford professor Sebastian Thrun stepped to the podium at the 2012 Digital Life Design Conference in Munich, most people in the audience expected to hear about driverless cars. Some were expecting an update on how real-time photographs of streets and buildings were changing Google's already booming online mapping business. A few insiders were expecting a preview of new virtual reality technology that could be worn like a pair of glasses and would allow wearers to see the internet embedded in the real world. Thrun was responsible for all this technology. He ran, in addition to his academic duties, an innovation laboratory at Google called...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.